Hi, I'm Stu from Hivemind Automation and welcome back to The Hive. In this video, we'll be taking a look at my new, to me, server, a Lenovo x3650 M5. This is going to be more of an overview of the server, and we'll talk about the what, the why, the where, and maybe even the how. So while I roll the intro, why don't you take a moment to subscribe? And if you hit the bell icon, you'll get notified when I release new videos each week. While you're at it, if you like what I do here and you want to support the channel, there are some affiliate links to smart home gadgets that you can buy for your very own smart home and support the channel at the same time in the video description below. Or you can support the channel directly through my Buy Me a Coffee link. Of course, those affiliate links and my Buy Me a Coffee link can all be found on my website, hivemindautomation.com.au. With all of that out of the way, let's get started. So I've mentioned before that in my day job, I work in the IT field, and for the last 9 years, I've been running UnRAID on a home lab server. I custom built this computer from off the shelf consumer parts about 9 years ago, and it has an Intel fourth generation 4790 processor, 32 gigabytes of RAM, which is the most that this motherboard can support and the best CPU that this motherboard can support. I filled the onboard storage controller with spinning Rust hard drives as well, which I've upgraded over the years to end up totaling a 40 terabyte storage array with a 1 terabyte write cache on faster SSD storage. Now, 9 years ago, this was more than enough for my needs, but over time, and especially as I started getting into YouTube, it's been struggling. I'm running an operating system called UnRAID, as I mentioned before, to manage this server. And I demonstrated in a previous video running Home Assistant in a VM on my UnRAID server. Now, UnRAID's a great OS for building large storage arrays without as many of the rules of traditional RAID, and it does add bonuses like a virtual machine hypervisor, and it works great as well as a Docker host. All of my media from my YouTube video shoots and other personal media like photos and videos is stored on the server. This is also the UnRAID SMB server that we ended up connecting to when we set up Home Assistant network mounts for backing up our Home Assistant configuration in a previous video as well. I ran anywhere up to 40 Docker containers on my old server, which honestly may have had a little bit to do with why it was struggling, but at any given time, more than half of those containers were probably shut down to preserve resources so that those critical containers would take the priority. For my video editing in DaVinci Resolve, I run a PostgreSQL Docker container, which is my central database for DaVinci Resolve. It means then that there's a central place where my DaVinci project data lives, and I can start editing on my laptop, save the edit, and then pick up editing on my gaming PC or vice versa, depending on whether I need a more color accurate screen or if I need more GPU power for various things. I also run Nextcloud, which is a little bit like having my own private Google Drive or Dropbox service in a Docker container on my server. My Mosquito MQTT broker runs in a container on my server as well. And there's a bunch of other supporting containers for everything else. A dynamic DNS updater, a number of different databases, a reverse proxy, photo libraries, backup tools, the list goes on. I have a ton more projects that I want to utilize my home lab server for, but I've been butting up against the limitations of the hardware that we have here. So the obvious solution then is to upgrade the hardware. So just before Christmas, I picked up this secondhand Lenovo x3650 M5 2U rack mount server from eBay for $2,000. It's not a small amount of money, but there's a reason why it cost that much. It has two Intel Xeon E5-2698 V4 CPUs. Each of those CPUs has 20 cores supporting 40 threads with hyperthreading enabled. Now, if my maths is correct, two CPUs with 40 threads makes for 80 processing threads. It also has 512 gigabytes of RAM. That's right, I said 512 gigabytes of RAM. From what I can tell, the mainboard in this server also supports up to 768 gigabytes of RAM. Just imagine how many Google Chrome tabs that you could have open with 768 gigabytes of RAM. As many as 12 Chrome tabs. Enough joking though, this is enterprise server hardware taken out of a known working environment. And being a proper server, it has features like dual redundant power supplies and tons of fans to keep air flowing over the heat sinks and the drives and other components. On the back, there's 4 1 gigabit Ethernet ports and a 5th gigabit Ethernet port for the integrated management interface, or IMM, which allows us to remotely monitor and start up or shut down the server even when it's powered off. So long as the power supplies have power going to them, you can log into the web console and click a button and the server will start up. It does feature these front drive bays, which are hot swappable 2.5 inch drive bays. In the configuration that I purchased, only 8 of these bays had a backplane behind them to plug a drive into and then subsequently be connected to the SAS RAID controller card that comes in this thing. I've since added a SAS expander that adds another 8 ports and a new backplane for a total of 16, and I believe it's also possible to get another 8 drive bays to max it out with 24 2.5 inch drive bays. So this new to me server should hopefully serve me pretty well for quite some time, and hopefully even the next 9 or 10 years. It is complete overkill for my requirements right now. But as I mentioned before, there's more projects that I want to start working on, and this new server is already going a long way to supporting those projects. I needed to migrate my existing drives over to the new server, which was reasonably simple, except for the fact that they were 3.5 inch hard drives, and I needed to do some kind of hacky workarounds to make those all connect into the server. It involved getting an HBA card, which is essentially just a hard drive controller, a couple of adapters, and some cables. My old 3.5 inch drives are still mounted in my old server case to both mount and power those 3.5 inch 8 terabyte drives until I can find someone who's going to buy a kidney from me so that I can then afford to populate all of the 2.5 inch drive bays with flash storage. I may consider implementing a better drive shelf setup in the not too distant future so that these drives are hot swappable and make upgrades or replacements a lot easier as well. But for the time being, it's working perfectly fine. Now, I have been working a little bit out of order here because there's actually another glaring problem with this upgrade. This server, running a heavy workload, getting the fans up to full speed, is loud. Before this project, the 9-year-old server that I'd been running had been running in my home office, sitting on a shelf in the bottom of the wardrobe, and it's been perfectly fine. It doesn't get loud at all, and especially having installed some Noctua fans and water cooling the CPU with an all-in-one water cooler from Cooler Master. The other problem is that this server is not exactly small. While it's only 2 rack units tall at the front, that's roughly 100 millimeters or 4 inches, it's 19 inches or 450 millimeters wide, because that's the standard width of server racks, and it's about 750 millimeters, nearly 30 inches deep. There's no way that this server was going to fit in my home office, or definitely not in the wardrobe. And even if it did, it was going to drive me nuts with how loud it is. Now, in fairness, it's unlikely, at least for the time being, to be running at a load that's spinning the fans at 100%, but the sheer size is still going to be a problem. So I finally went about buying a proper server rack. It's an 18U rack, so not the full height data center rack that you might be used to seeing. And I also picked up some rails to mount the server into the rack. We recently sold our upright freezer, which we hadn't used for years, and it was just taking up space in the garage here. So the rack is in the space that the freezer left. And that's why you might have noticed the B-roll shots that you've seen as we're going through this have been happening in the garage. This also means that I'm going to need to reconfigure some parts of my home network, because I ran Ethernet cables to my office when I had the router and the core switch set up in there. I've realized for some time now that the correct place for the core switch and router was always the garage, because that's where the NBN NTD or network termination device is, where the fiber internet connection comes into the house. Now, thankfully, for the most part, I did leave myself enough cable length to be able to move the connections to the garage, and it shouldn't cause myself too much grief when I do finally go about doing that. I may need to rerun a couple of cable drops, but I can certainly live with that to get a much tidier result at the other end of the project, and I already wanted to run more Ethernet cable anyway. Having shuffled around our home offices over the Christmas break, it'd be nice to have Ethernet connections behind our desks. So with the server racked and stacked in the new rack in the garage, everything hooked up, UnRAID up and running and recognizing all of my drives from the old server, it's time to look at a bit of a before and after comparison. If I pop over now to an SSH session that I have on my new server here, and I'll run HTOP, and would you look at that? Those 80 processing threads just fill the top of the screen there. And you'll also note that none of those processors are working particularly hard. This number 64 here is running at about 75%, but there's very few other processor cores that are really running harder. You'll also note here that the amount of memory that we're using is it's a lot higher than it was on the older device. We're pushing 95 gigabytes of used memory, but 503 total is really not a big deal there. And you'll also note that our swap is also at zero, whereas I'm not 100% sure, but on the other one, I'm pretty sure our swap was a lot higher because we just didn't have the memory to really support that just running as cleanly as we would like. This HTOP with the 80 threads at the top there just really is a sight to behold. Heading over now to the UnRAID console interface, you'll see again we've got the processor cores here, and like, it's just outrageous that I have to scroll so far to see a representation of all of the threads. And again, we see we've got one of these cores is working a little bit hard, and then we've got one core that's just pegged itself to 100% for a moment there. And I think if we look back here, yeah, it looks like just CrashPlan's running a backup right now as I'm recording this video, and it does just take up a fair bit of processing power to handle that. But as we scroll further down, we see that this graph, it's just sitting there. It's barely getting up to about 20% of our total capacity there, I'd say. And as we scroll further down, we've got our memory stats here with the 512 gig of multi-bit ECC RAM. So this is error-correcting RAM as well. And pushing hard, like just shy of 100 gig there. But on the old server, that graph was just completely full. So it made it very difficult for us to actually really add any additional functionality to the server in that previous setup with the hardware limitations that we had. And you can also see the four Ethernet ports there, all full gigabit. I only have one of those Ethernet ports connected into the network at the moment. I don't have the big switch in that rack just yet. I'll be adding that a little bit later. So with those 40 cores and 80 threads, I can easily start up all of my Docker containers and still have plenty of headroom to spin up virtual machines, which if we head over to our VMs, now I've given up on running virtual machines on my old UnRAID server purely because I just didn't have any more resources to assign to it. But as you saw on a previous video, we've been able to set up this Home Assistant demo instance running in a VM on UnRAID, and we've given it four CPUs and 4 gigs of RAM. It's running perfectly fine. It actually runs zippier than my production instance of Home Assistant, which is running on a Raspberry Pi compute module 4 in the Home Assistant yellow. And you see here, I've also got a Windows 10 VM running here. Again, I've got 32 gigs of RAM, and I've even given it 24 CPUs. So I'm really not shy about throwing resources at these virtual machines now because I have plenty of them available. So that's my new, to me, server, the Lenovo x3650 M5. Now, as I mentioned, this is going to allow me to undertake some new projects and hopefully help me streamline some of my video production workflows as well. Now, I definitely could have looked at some cloud services for some of this functionality, but my primary use case for this server is storage, and specifically storage of the raw footage that makes up these YouTube videos. 4K video files aren't what you could call small, and Australian internet connections, at least as they stand right now, don't really allow for decent transfer rates to the internet. So local storage is the best option for my particular use case. Not to mention the cost of cloud storage at the volumes that I need are definitely out of my price range. We will also be utilizing this server for some other interesting projects coming up soon as well, including using AI to detect things that are happening in video streams from our security cameras and passing that information on to Home Assistant. Now, obviously, deploying a server like this in your own home is not for everyone. But I do know that there's a decent sized community of people who do run home labs, and even some YouTube channels like Serve the Home dedicated to exactly this kind of thing. So you might be asking, is running a server like this at home for you? And I can honestly say that it's probably not. If you're just after lots of network attached storage, you'd probably be better off with something like a Synology NAS. Most of those also support running services as Docker containers on them. So you would be able to do things like even run a Home Assistant in a Docker container on that. But you won't then have access to a virtual machine on a Synology. If you are running a small business from home, though, like what I'm trying to do here, especially if it's a tech-centric or content creation type of business, then something like this might actually be a good investment for you. Obviously, your use case is yours, mine is mine. Now, in a future video, I will be taking a look at integrating UnRAID into Home Assistant so that I can then set up automations to, for example, start or stop my virtual machines or Docker containers based on time of day or other things around. And then even also then gather some information about UnRAID, gather that information, track that in Home Assistant, and maybe even set up automations to do certain things based on the state of my UnRAID server as well. As always, let me know your thoughts in the comments section down below. That's all we have for this video, and I do hope that it's helped you in your home automation and even home server journey. Be sure to drop a comment below with a home automation idea that you'd like to see me cover in a future video. And don't forget to follow Hivemind Automation on Instagram and Facebook. If you like this video, hit the thumbs up button down below to give it a like. And if you're not already subscribed, now's a great time to consider changing that. While you're at it, if you hit the bell icon, you can get notified when I release new videos, which is normally each week. And lastly, if you like what I'm doing here and you want to support the channel, there's a Buy Me a Coffee link in the video description below. Any contribution you make through Buy Me a Coffee does get put towards making more and hopefully better content for you to enjoy. Don't forget to check out my website, hivemindautomation.com.au. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Stu from Hivemind Automation, and I'm looking forward to seeing you next time. Bye for now.